Barton here. We're going to be installing a cycle analyst 2.4. I bought it at Green Technologies, and a cycle analogger. Your cycle analyst will come with your cycle analyst, and in this case, we have a remote magnet and a remote shunt because we have the HC model. The shunt I purchased for my bike is the 0.1 ohm. It's the largest one you can find at Green Technologies because I have a size 6 controller. You will get a power cable. This is an extension cable. You will get a data logger cable. This is just a stereo cable. You will get a data cable, just a USB cable here, to be able to pull data off your data logger. Now this is the GPS model, so it also stores GPS. And it has an 8 gig card installed stock. You have this data cable here that you can solder onto one of these boards. I don't know which board, I'm not gonna use it, so we're just gonna toss it. You also get complimentary zip ties. You're gonna need a lot more than this. If you only use this, you're doing it wrong. You also get this magnet. This magnet is probably gonna be useless to you unless you have spokes on your bike. So if this will fit neatly into your rotor, your disc rotor, your front disc rotor, or your rear disc rotor, whichever one you prefer to use, then you might be able to recycle it, cutting off the back, just epoxy it in place. If not, you're gonna have to get some neodymium magnets. That'll fit nicely. These are the closest thing I could find. We're gonna use these and we're gonna epoxy them in place with JB Weld. The reason we're using JB Weld over other epoxies is its operating temperature. It's 250 degrees higher than anything else you'll find at your local hardware store. You will also need a big cable that goes from your negative terminal to your shunt, and the other existing cable will go from here to your controller or your battery, whichever way you have it configured. This is a massive cable. It is oversized for what I'm gonna do, but it's flexible, so I don't care. You're gonna need probably a whole bunch of heat shrink. This is different sizes, pretty cheap. Just have some around. Per Doc Bass's recommendations, we are going to isolate these four sensing wires, which connect to the shunt, from the cycle analyst and the shunt. The shunt connects to your controller and your battery, so we're gonna isolate these two so they don't have a chance of blowing one another up. We're gonna do that with 1 amp fuses, 1 amp 250 volt fuses, and these are just the holders for them. We're gonna solder them in place, use the heat shrink, make it all nice. We might end up using the SAE connectors to make this all pretty. We might just end up going with these. These are stronger, these are weaker. I might just put these in place, and I might even cover them. Because they are so flimsy. Now, this is magic sauce. Right now, this is soldered. This is supposed to connect to the battery terminal positive, but it's just a little itty bitty soldered wire. How are we gonna do that? We're gonna use this. This is a 14, I think it goes up to a 14 gauge. Maybe it's only, yeah, it goes up to a 14 gauge because it's yellow. And you could see it's the same size as this hole here. You have on your controller an 8 mil or 10 mil bolt that needs to go through this hole. And if it doesn't, we'll just cut it and it'll slide in. It'll be perfect, it'll be great. Right now we're stuck in the living room. Soon we'll be in the garage. We haven't quite made it to the garage yet. Wanted to stop here and share something that people probably don't think about if you're working with heat shrink for the first time. And there's always a first time. Is staging. When you are about to solder connections together, you need to think ahead and think, what needs to be covered with heat shrink and what needs to be what I call staged up. Now what is staging up? This might be hard to see, but there are three levels of heat shrink here so that I can increase this final size to a certain diameter so it's better received by another piece of heat shrink. In this case, this wire is going to end up going in this. So when this heat shrink gets down, it has a minimal diameter that it will shrink to. And because this heat shrink has three levels on it now, three levels, it'll better adhere to this without me having to do what I call crimping. If you take a big heat shrink, in this case it fits over this adapter, and you put it on a small wire like this, you're going to have to crimp off the excess if you expect it to seal tightly. Now why are we doing this? First, there is a gap in here and water can get in. I do not like water, so I'm going to stage all of these up, and technically I could have heat shrink these down to begin with. I just left them loose so you can see what I'm doing. For the bottom sections, I have a piece of heat shrink that is just big enough to slip over the tube. On the smaller wires, I have staged them up at least one of the small, you can see them here, one of the small heat shrinks. And then on this one, I've actually staged it up again, this white wire, because it's so thin. And since these two are going to be together like this, I actually have another step. These two little ones that just fit over the ends here, they're going to solder there, they're going to slip over. Then this big one that's going to slip over this whole thing to keep it together so that it doesn't get too far apart. Now this strengthens this whole thing so it doesn't flex. And that's what I'm trying to grab out of here. Now, even this section. After I solder this all together, there's going to be four wires coming off of this. It's going to be loose and flimsy. I'm then going to slide over another piece that'll fit over all of that. And then over that, I'm going to slide over another piece. And that's going to just build strength. You'll see it in a second when it's done. And maybe you'll better understand why I do this. But I figured I'd share it for the people who are new to heat shrink. I've got this to a point where I can illustrate what I was talking about before. So I've gone and shrinked these, crimped them in some cases not. The red wire was installed and crimped. These wires were soldered on, and they had the shrink tubing that fit over the 14 gauge wires here, slid up, shrink down, and then this will now go over this all the way up, and it'll provide strength. Just like this one's really strong now. Down here where the four wires meet, I have shrunk their heat shrinking that fit over the 14 gauge wire, done over the other wires, and you can see how it's all flimsy, which you might like, you might not like. But now what I'll do is I'll gather all these together, and then I'll slide this first level of heat shrink over top. And then once that's done, I'll slide the second one, and it'll be even stronger. You'll see that in a moment. All right, this is the aftermath. We have the two levels here. You can see it's no longer really flimsy. It brings all the cores together. They're really nice. They act a little together, I guess. You could also see that it's staged. You have the bigger layer underneath here, and then you have the larger layer on top. Typically, when you cut these, you want your largest layer to be the biggest, and then you just scale them down as you go. Then you have these two wires that were joined together, and now they're more together. And again, the reason you do this is to reduce the movement of the wire near the terminals. So this is ready to install on the bike. From here, we're going to go towards the bike. We are finally in the garage. We're going to install the magnets. So I have two neodymium magnets. You'll see why we're using two in a second. I have a little plastic zip tie thing I'll use to mix the JB Weld, and of course I have a JB Weld. Now I've gone ahead and cleaned the rotor with just simple isopropyl alcohol. You could use brake cleaner, whatever you want, just get it clean. And then I backed it with this clear packing tape. Now the reason we need two, one would sit flush in here, which is fine, but this sensor, the closer you can get this sensor to the magnet, the better. The problem are these little, I don't even know what to call them. There's some type of screw or bolt. Well, I guess they're not a bolt, but you know what I mean. These hold on the disc rotor, and these get in the way of this when it's mounted. Now, I'm going to be mounting this on this rod that goes up here, and I'll have to move the light and take another shot just so you can see this. But this is the rod right here, and this holds on here and here, but in between these two, it's hollow. So I'll be able to take the zip ties that were included, run them through here, put that on there, but it's going to be a distance off of this so that it doesn't hit it. And that's why we're going to use two, because this will let it stick out a little bit extra. And I'll probably put epoxy on the outsides of these so that they also have less likely chance of flinging off the bike, but they're neodymium magnets. I'm not too worried about it. Let me throw the epoxy on, we'll set this in there, and we'll see what we have. The magnet is installed. I had to rotate the bike, the front wheel at least, so that the magnet was facing down, so it'd force it towards the outer edge of the rotor. I then went back and cleaned up all the excess JB Weld with some Q-tips and just a little bit of rubbing alcohol. That's why it looks relatively clean. So this needs to cure for, I think, 18 to 24 hours. Not riding my bike tomorrow, not too worried about it. I'll leave exactly where it's at and continue to install everything else. We have a wire installed. This is a very odd angle. You can see the hall sensors here. It's zip tied to that arm I was talking about before. Now, if this isn't close enough to the rotor, because it's going to be roughly the same height as this thing here, the magnet, if it's not close enough, I will shift, I'll just put a shim in here and re-zip tie it so it sits out a little further. As long as it doesn't hit this, we're good. Now that just runs up the brake line, and from there, let me grab the light here. From there, I mounted the cycloanalyst here. The cords come out the left side. It's gonna be the best spot for me. And then the main cords come out through here and run down the left side. Now, you might be thinking, what is all this crap that I got going on in the center here? If you recall, my bike is heavily modified. The bird's nest is on top. There's a lot of experimental stuff going on in here. I have my RFID ignition, I have my twist start stop. There's a whole bunch of stuff. Don't worry about it. Yours won't look like this. It'll just have wires running left, wires running right. Just run the wires down the left and then feed your fuses through the little spot here and just throw the slack up into your controller. And now you might be asking, where's the shunt? Originally I was gonna put the shunt back here, but this cable, the 4-0 oversized cable, is too inflexible. Even though it is flexible, it's too inflexible to do some odd stuff with it. And because I have a size 6 controller on a bike that previously had a size 4, remember this is 2013, and it used to be used for racing, so it's got a size 6, the ground cable wasn't long enough. So what I had to do is I had to change my stack. If you notice that my Anderson connector positive here is on top of the battery connector, the positive battery connector, and over here it's underneath. I did that to raise it up a bit so that I could clear the ribs, and then I just went straight down into this empty void here. And from there, I took the battery cable, just looped it back on itself to the other side. Now you might be wondering, where's that black thing that was on the bottom of the shunt? It broke. It broke before I even could put it on, and I didn't even have to drop it. It's cheap plastic. They have it up there so you could isolate it and mount it someplace. I think I'm gonna isolate it by just wrapping this thing with some type of tape. I can't really heat shrink it. I'll think of something to isolate it better. It's kind of just floating in space though, so I'm not really worried about it. And all the wires around here are insulated and well protected. Don't think it'll be an issue, but I probably will isolate it more. Now all I have left to do is run the power connector, which the power to this device is fed from the positive here and the negative here, and then the data connector here we'll have to connect to the analogger, which will probably sit down in here, and this will get cleaned up. Now, this is all gonna change when the DigiNail chargers come, because it actually goes into space, and I've been pre-setting this up for that, because all the stuff on here is gonna be flush left, all the stuff on the right is gonna be flush right, and all the stuff that's in the center is gonna be tossed back here, or it'll be tossed in my space up front, because I have made a plate here to reclaim some space. And previously I had a plate up here for 2 winters that was clear, just to block rain. And then what I did is I modified this one. This is just sheet metal, so that it mounts into the battery as well. A little stronger. I have my Sevcon DC to DC in there. You can probably see a little here. And it can support a lot more weight. So there'll be stuff shoved up in here. This whole section will be clear. There'll be chargers. That's coming soon. Hopefully soon. But for now, I'm going to hook all this stuff up. See if I can get it to run, and we might even do a configuration video for the cycle analyst.